Health In Show. Today is August 2, 2012. We're broadcasting out of Pennsylvania, a live interview with Elaine Lewis, homeopath extraordinaire from, everybody knows her from the greatest website on the internet, HPathy. And I'm learning so much about her because I've been in communication with her over the, I guess, 3 years now, at least 3 years. And we started on Homeopathy World Community together and have had conversations on Facebook and talking about cases. And she's just an incredible comedian, lively and so much fun. So, it's like you're sitting with the Simpsons. I want to thank Amnon Nissan of Nissan Communications for doing the show at an off day and an odd hour and getting the whole arrangement to, what do we call this, Amnon? It's distance or remote. This is a remote broadcast. So yeah. Anything is possible. Mm-hmm. So especially when you have such sweet and loving people like Amnon in this world. So we also have Shayna as a special treat. It's her daughter, Elaine's daughter. So we're going to be talking today, and everybody's been wondering what this is all about. It's what's it called when there's a sequence of events that just doesn't happen right? A comedy of errors? Well, we originally scheduled it for 2:30, and that's why the banner says 2:30. I never repaired it. We're actually live at 1:30 in the afternoon, Eastern Time, USA.
So with any luck, no one will see this show.
That's what she's hoping. So in the meantime, we're going to be first, we want to do a little bit of history about Elaine. And you can tell us something about yourself, about your love for music. Because all you have to do is say a word or a phrase, and she starts going into song and, I don't know, dance too.
Where is the homeopathy theme song?
Oh, we need the homeopathy theme song because she prepared it diligently.
It's called You're My Remedy.
Incredible remedy, Arnica, but that's going to be after Elaine tells us a little bit more about what she does on HPathy and how she writes every month a story, or is it a quiz?
It's a quiz.
She writes a quiz for readers.
It's for the easing, the HPathy easing. Mm-hmm. It's called Homeopathy for Everyone, and it's free, and it comes out once a month. And some really famous people have written for it, George Vitholkis, and I've interviewed Robin Murphy for it.
He was my teacher, yeah.
Miranda Castro.
Yes.
And speaking of Miranda Castro, yes. Shayna, get me my quote from Miranda Castro.
Okay, she has a backup person, and she used to manage a song group, music group. Okay.
Now, this is my favorite quote from Miranda Castro, because we all, I think, have some idea that when we take a case from somebody, that they're just supposed to ramble on and on and on. And at some point you might say, oh, what's that like? And then they ramble on and on again. And you say, well, what does that feel like? And then they and, you know, I don't know about chronic cases, but certainly for acute cases, that approach is not going to help you.
In the immediacy of the moment, you need to take care of that person, huh? So rambling doesn't work.
The thing is, in homeopathy, all we're trying to do is find a remedy. We're trying to match this person to a homeopathic remedy. And to do that, there are specific things we have to know. And they're not going to tell you those things.
They won't?
No. They're not going to tell you that I have ailments from cold, dry winds. They're not going to say that. You're going to have to ask. It's all about what you ask them. You have to know what to ask people.
I've always learned that you don't
lead. You see, but
lead.
That's wrong. No. Oh, see, this is Miranda.
Okay.
And this is, don't take my word for
okay,
it. This
here's
is
the
Miranda
quote.
Castro. Etiology, again, like nutrition, is a big topic. Etiology is a very high-level symptom. It's right up there. One of the highest. The correct remedy has to have the etiology covered. We have to know it. I am ruthless about this with patients, and I let them know that. I will back people into a corner until I get what I need. I mean, I will chase down that etiology if I have to. And so, if I'm at a point where people start saying the same things over and over, and I haven't gotten the information I need, and I haven't gotten the etiology, I will take charge and chase it down.
She's ruthless. How does she chase it?
You have to get certain information from people, and they're not going to give it to you. And this is why so many homeopaths don't take acute cases, because they're not being trained to do that. They're being trained to take constitutional cases.
Mm-hmm.
They're being trained to say, what is that like for you? What does that feel like? What does this mean when you do that?
So it goes along. It's a long case-taking process. Is your case-taking process as long?
No. It should not take long to take an acute case.
Okay.
There are specific things you need, and that is why I have an acute case questionnaire.
She has, and you know what? I was really surprised. It's about 2 pages long, but it's not a fill-in-the-blank or a multiple choice. They are essay questions, right?
And I suppose. The point is, there are specific things you need to know to take an acute case, and the acute is not just an excuse to take the chronic case. Or the constitutional case.
Okay.
It is not an excuse. It's a real thing. You have to take the acute case.
Okay.
A phosphorus person is not going to need phosphorus for his flu if he's thirstless.
Oh, okay. And is that possible that a phosphorus constitutional person might go into a state where they would be thirstless and need a different remedy?
Absolutely. This
okay.
is why we have to take an acute case properly as an acute case and not just see it as, oh, this is a great way for me to find this person's constitutional remedy and just throw their acute case out.
It's very important to take what you're looking at right now.
Yes, you have to prescribe for what's in front of you, not for what the way they were yesterday or the day before, but for what they're presenting to you right now.
Mm-hmm.
Hence the questionnaire.
Oh, we have this fabulous questionnaire, and everybody's been waiting with bated breath to hear what are the questions. And we're going to go through them as best we can, cover them as in totality. Mm-hmm. So it starts off, you know, you have to put your name and your age, male or female, weight, height, date, and address, because Elaine takes all of these cases via the internet, via
mostly
email.
But also, I carry this around with me.
You do?
I fold it up. I put it in my back pocket in case I happen to run into a sick person, which happens.
Oh, my goodness.
And I don't want to be caught like a deer in the headlights saying, oh, that sounds pretty bad. Maybe you should go see a doctor.
Uh-huh.
You know, I want, if this can happen to people easily, this can easily happen to a homeopath when they run into a person
yes.
with an acute, because it can be very
can
frightening. They can be too scared to take the case because it sounds so scary. It's like, oh my God. You have all that wrong with you?
Okay.
Oh, maybe you should see a doctor. The only thing is you just have to know what to ask. That's all. You just have to have the questions, and you can do this.
So the homeopath is in an acute emergency type of a situation where even though the patient or the person who's in dire need of help who might be in shock, the homeopath could be in a state of shock, not knowing how to react. And having a questionnaire of this sort would be a supportive element so that
the homeopath doesn't panic and doesn't feel like, oh, this is way over my head.
Right.
I can't do this.
And this could go for a parent, maybe, to
mm-hmm.
take care of an immediate situation. I want to tell the folks out there, I was surprised to learn that Elaine carries around with her a dose of Arnica wherever she goes.
Wait,
and
I got it.
She's going to pull it out of her pocket. and I'm going to tell you that this is really something, because I was surprised.
Here it is in my pocket.
It's well worn. It's very tiny. It's a liquid dropper. And the thing about it is, she's used it.
Oh, yeah, I've used it.
And she told me a story that really shows how keeping it with you is handy. I even came here without my kit and without Arnica, without anything, thinking,
dough!
Elaine's got it for me. So you want to tell the folks the story about...
Oh, okay. So I was in Whole Foods parking garage, minding my own business like I always do.
No, not really.
And there was an old man walking towards the elevator platform. And I guess his eyesight was bad because he did not see that there was a step up to the elevator. And he just kept on going and landed flat on his face. And he screamed and cried like a baby. So I ran over to him, I walked very fast. And I knelt down and I said, now don't worry, I'm a homeopath.
Did that make him into panic?
And I pulled my Arnica 10M out of my pocket and I said, open your mouth.
Like a little bird.
And he looked at me like, what? He had enough presence of mind to go, what? But he took it anyway. And in less than 5 minutes,
mm-hmm.
he was sitting up and talking calmly about what he should do. do you think I broke my nose? What do you think I should do? Do you think I should go to the emergency room? I'm supposed to take a plane tomorrow. Do you think I should go on my vacation or cancel my vacation? Well, what do you think? Do you think my nose is broken?
So by giving this remedy, he retained his presence of being.
He recovered. He completely.
But
he
what about his nose?
Well, it was red.
But it wasn't
broken.
Of course.
I don't know if it was. He did decide to go to the emergency.
And I would always recommend to go to see a physician to get an x-ray to find out if there is something that needs repair.
So he got up. He walked back to his car. He knocked on his car window and he says to his wife, "You're not going to believe what just happened."
And I bet this happens all the time with Elaine.
I've also injured myself. I walked into my favorite restaurant, Sabrina's in South Philadelphia on 912 Christian Street, and they had just mopped the floor and hadn't told anybody. So I went in and went sliding into the doorway and went crashing down on my left knee because my right leg went flying out from under me. And it took two waitresses to pull me up and onto a chair. I couldn't even get up by myself. And so I pulled out my bottle of Arnica. I was not the least bit concerned.
She was not concerned.
I was not the least bit concerned about what just happened to me. I gave myself a dose of Arnica. People were flocking around me, wanting to know if I wanted to go to the hospital and wanted to know if I wanted to fill out an accident report, and I was just waving everyone away.
But isn't that the mind of an Arnica saying?
No, I just knew that I was going to be fine because I had taken Arnica. And I ate my breakfast.
Yeah.
And 45 minutes later, I got up and walked out.
Okay, so we know the power of Arnica is very strong. And this is a 10M, folks. This is a very high potency.
I don't usually carry
it with me. Oh, have you been waiting for the questionnaire? We're going to get started with it now. So the first question is, describe the complaint or complaints in your own words in as much detail as you can. Don't forget to include the onset. That's, did the complaint come on suddenly or gradually? So what are you looking for here?
Well, they have to tell you what happened.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
To a large degree, you have to know that in their own words, what happened. And, of course, without that, none of your other questions make any sense.
Okay.
So, and especially you want to know if their complaint came on suddenly or gradually, because we have sudden onset remedies, belladonna and aconite chief among them. So when you hear that, oh, it came on suddenly, I was fine. And then this actually happened to me once. Literally, I was walking up the stairs. I was fine at the bottom of the stairs, but halfway up the stairs, I was like, I'm sick.
Oh, really?
And
that's as fast as it can happen.
Yeah.
So is this
That's
influenza?
A sudden onset. It was a virus.
It was a virus.
Yeah.
Okay, so then there are remedies that you know
that have sudden onset. Belladonna. Okay. Has sudden onset, aconite, mm-hmm. Baptisia.
Baptisia is also, mm-hmm. and that's a really...
That's lesser known. It's lesser known that that has a sudden onset.
Okay, and that's pretty bad. You feel
really bad.
You feel like all of your limbs are separated from your body.
Baptisia is like gelsimium, only worse.
And gelsimium has got a lot of anxiety. and
well, you know, it does have stage fright, but it's a certain kind. It's a stage fright or an anxiety about appearing in public.
Well, just like a panic attack, anxiety attack, like when, let's say something is going, you hear about an epidemic that is going around, you might go into a gelsemium state, would you not?
But it's a certain kind of state.
Okay, maybe you can explain it.
Yeah, as distinct from, say, an aconite panic attack, which is kind of very vigorous.
Okay.
Gelsemium is kind of a collapsed state. Mm-hmm. Your legs are shaking, trembling. You feel drained. You feel like the life is going out of you. You just feel like you need to lie down somewhere. It's a whole different energy than the aconite panic or even the argent mite panic. Argent mite people do a lot of pacing.
Okay.
They're so nervous.
Okay.
Gelsemium feels sick.
Yes.
When they're nervous and they're having this panic situation. So, yeah, even though they have anxiety, when I say that baptisia is like gelsemium, only worse, mm-hmm. I mean that baptisia has this sick feeling like gelsemium, only even worse than that.
Right.
It's
more
like
intensified.
Turned up. Yes.
Turned up the volume.
Yeah.
Okay. Question number two. Etiology is something that you started to talk about. This means the cause, if you know what it is. Think about what was going on at or around the time of the occurrence of this acute problem. The answer may be obvious if you were stung by a bee, ate a big fatty meal, or fell out of a tree. But less obvious etiologies would include things like the weather, suppression, I was very angry but said nothing. Ooh. Okay. I had a rash and suppressed it with some sort of cream, which happens all the time, our favorite cortisone.
Yeah.
After that, I started feeling bad. So it gives you a clue what to do. So you've got a whole list of things that they could choose from, like overstudy, receiving good news or bad news, having to put up with
rudeness.
Yeah,
you have to give people examples,
okay,
or they will not be able to answer you.
Okay.
They'll just say no or I don't know.
Typically.
Or they'll tell you something completely useless, like especially when you get to the modalities question and you say what makes your case better or worse, and they say aspirin.
We don't need to know aspirin. There's a lot of things she was mentioning earlier to me that people will come in and give you blood work, lab.
Yeah.
X-rays, this, that, and the other thing. But in a situation of an acute case, you need specific answers. And that's what you're looking for in order to narrow down from thousands of remedies,
right,
to just a few. So she gives a whole list of possible examples. And do you find that people will just like circle one, or do they actually give you their personal?
Unfortunately, sometimes, this is why I give so many examples, mm-hmm, because I've had people just say, don't have that, but I have that,
right,
and I have that, but I don't have that. These are examples.
These are examples, i.e., we want people to think out of the box, think about themselves,
yes,
get into their own body and their own person, and think about their day and how it came upon them,
mm-hmm,
rather than trying to find the answer in the questionnaire.
Right.
And, you know, I was asking earlier about the weather, mm-hmm, and whether this is, you had an example of cold wind.
Oh, yes. Somebody told me that their asthma was absolutely the worst if she had to go out on a windy day. that would just put the nail in the coffin, that wind.
For that person.
For that person. And so I knew that I had to go to generals when aggravates to find that remedy.
Okay, so in other words,
it would have to be there.
You have to cover what's going on with the person. So if you're a mom, or if you're an athletic manager, a sports coach, or something like that, you need to cover those particular things. Okay, let's see. Okay, so let's see. We've got number three, sensation. Describe the pain and other feeling you have. Does it extend anywhere? Does it shoot anywhere? For instance, it feels like there's a crumb in my throat. I'm constantly trying to swallow. The pain shoots to my left ear.
So, yeah, that's what we need. We don't need people telling us that they have a sore throat. That means nothing to us.
Okay.
Absolutely nothing. I have a sore throat. Can't help you. We don't have a remedy for that. You have to tell us something about that sore throat. You have to describe it. What does it feel like? What's the sensation? Is it raw? Is it burning? Is it on both sides? Just one side? Does it shoot to the ear when you swallow? These are all the things. We have to know all this, or we can't find a remedy.
And most people don't pay attention to it, are not used to going into such adjectives, descriptive explanations. They just say, it hurts.
Right.
Leave me alone. It hurts. And we need to find out these specifics in order to narrow down to the right remedy. And basically, it's a matter of education.
Mm-hmm.
We need to let them know how to do that. And once they do that, they can really learn about themselves and the pattern that they go into every time they get sick. Right?
Well, I didn't know that. See,
no.
Usually, I mean, I've had the flu many times, and it's been a different remedy practically every time.
Ooh, interesting.
Yeah. I've had, my very first flu was an arsenicum flu.
Okay. So you were restless.
I was very needy. I really felt that if someone didn't come and stay with me, I would die. Okay. I was just desperate to have someone come and stay with me. I was calling all over.
So that's a clue, folks.
That's an arsenicum state when you see that. And also, do you have to go? Please don't go. Could you just stay 5 more minutes? Yeah. And usually when you're with an arsenicum patient, you feel like you're not going to be able to get away. It's very scary.
Oh.
It's like, they're not going to let me leave. I'm never going to be able to leave. You start becoming desperate to leave these people because they are so needy.
I just learned a lot.
Oh, okay. Oh. That was my first flu. I haven't had a flu like that since.
It's a good thing. I wouldn't want to be there.
The last flu I had was a gelsemium flu.
Oh, yeah.
And the main thing about that flu was that I was simply cold, freezing. I just wanted to go to bed and get under a ton of covers. And just
arsenicum is cold too. They're chilly. But they're but this one you weren't needy.
No, I was not the least bit needy. So you can have the same diagnosis over and over again and not necessarily need the same remedy.
Okay, we need to learn that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, number four.
And especially if there are mentals in your acute.
Okay.
The remedy, you can't ignore that. the remedy has to cover the mentals.
Okay.
Absolutely. If you
give me an example of this mentals.
Well, the arsenic description. Mm-hmm. You don't have to know anything else about that person's flu. If you see that, just give them arsenic. Don't bother asking any more questions. Don't ask them what makes you better or worse.
So then they will release you from their grip.
Yeah. That's arsenic. You don't need to know anything beyond that. With Baptisia and gelsimium, uh-huh. There's an apathy on the mental and emotional plane. Apathy.
Okay.
They don't care. Mm-hmm. They don't care. If you stay, that's fine with them. If you leave, that's fine with them. You asked, did you want me to stay with you?
No energy at all. Total loss of energy.
Total loss of energy.
So what you're saying is you might be prescribing on what I would call a keynote or a symptom picture that you recognize what this person looks like and say, oh, this is so obvious.
But there are keynotes on the physical plane too.
Okay.
But I'm just saying, if your virus that you're seeing or having has a mental state, the remedy has to match that. And the only thing that would trump that would be the etiology. That's why etiology is so important. And that means
okay.
The cause.
The cause.
By the way. So, for instance, one of our more famous etiologies is ailments from head injury, which is almost always NatSulf.
Natrium sulfuric.
Right. And so it wouldn't really matter whether that person was acting clingy or apathetic or whatever, but because you know the etiology,
uh-huh.
And that's what this remedy is famous for, ailments from head injury,
uh-huh.
You're going to just give NatSulf right away. NatSulf is especially famous for headache after head injury and depression after head injury. And so...
And they don't like humidity.
Oh, okay.
Right? And so this is, we're telling you this because this is this, right now we're going in the Olympics and all of those athletes out there need to know when they do have this severe head injury. Arnica?
Yeah, just always give arnica for blunt trauma. Just, you don't even think about it. And this is another example of etiology. Mm-hmm. Everyone knows that when someone is injured with a blunt injury.
Trauma.
Yeah. You give arnica right away. No one takes an arnica case.
But
no what's your favorite food?
She's being silly right now. But typically you might have to differentiate between like an aconite, which is like fear I'm going to die any second,
yes.
Or arnica,
right.
Meaning don't touch me. So those are things mm-hmm. that you would need
yeah.
to know.
Right.
Number four on your profile questionnaire says appearance. So anything remarkable. And
right.
This is kind of...
Appearance, because like gelsimium looks very dull.
Mm-hmm.
Very dull.
Glassy, droopy eyes.
Yes, droopy.
Droopy.
Droopy and dull. So, yes, appearance.
And belladonna.
Red.
Flushed
red.
And so, basically, if you are knowledgeable about a handful of remedies, even 10 or 20, you can get along pretty good in an acute situation before you run to the hospital. And by the time you get there, you'll be okay.
Right.
number five is location. Where on the body is your complaint?
Right, because we have left-sided remedies and right-sided remedies, you know.
Not everybody knows that.
No, okay.
Right? So we do, so meaning what? That let's say you get that sore throat and it begins on the left side. or the right side?
Left sided sore throat, we're more likely to think of Lachesis, maybe, especially if other symptoms confirm it. Like,
worse when they worse aggravation when getting up in the morning.
Sleep aggravates. Got worse when I was, when I woke up, it was worse than when I went to sleep. Yeah.
So that would be a Lachesis. So that's a remedy we've talked about a lot on these shows. Now, when you fell and slipped like on a banana peel and you injured your left, you were very specific about saying your left knee. Did that matter that
no.
it was one side or another?
No.
No, that was just a plain injury.
Yes.
Okay, so when...
Because it wasn't my body that decided to put the injury on my left knee. It was the restaurant decided.
Okay, so you're saying that something that's externally imposed, like an injury,
yeah.
the side is not what's really
right.
accounting. But if it's right. something that comes from within,
right.
then your body is giving you some information.
Yes.
Okay, that clarifies that. Number six is modalities. Now,
that's a very important question
okay.
for us.
For people who don't know very much about homeopathy, what are modalities?
We really have to know the modalities. These are the things that make the complaint better and worse.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes that's the most important information we have. When a person says to me, my child's nose is stopped up,
mm-hmm.
my first question is, okay, when is it not stopped up? Oh, it's not stopped up in the bath.
Okay.
Oh, it's not stopped up when we go outside. Oh, it's not stopped up in the daytime. Just at night. So these are all important clues. We have remedies. We have nose obstruction remedies that are better outside, worse inside.
I even read like going into a room.
Yes, going into a warm room. My nose stops up going into a warm room. Right. That would be allium sepa.
Oh, cool.
And pulsatilla.
Uh-huh.
And even when, and pulsatilla can be chilly, but even when they're chilly, they still want the window open. They're still better for fresh air and worse for the windows, all the windows being closed
mm-hmm.
in the house.
Okay.
So. Yeah, those modality questions, they really important.
And she has a list of those on the questionnaire.
Right, because if you say to someone, what makes you better or worse, they say, nothing!
Right, we don't want that answer. So do you have to prompt them in such some
oh, yes.
way? Do you have to
you
say
have
like...
to give a list.
You
and
have to give a list.
And then you say, but don't limit yourself to that list. But
okay.
this is just... to give you an idea.
Think about, let's say, your body position, time of day,
mm-hmm.
the weather. What things, if you're eating, like, isn't there one that if you're eating ice cream, you can get a headache after eating ice cream, but you eating ice cream might make you feel better. It makes me feel better.
Better ice cream.
Better ice cream. Okay. And then so the questionnaire says, these are examples. Think about your case. What makes you feel somewhat better? What makes you feel worse? Another way of thinking about the question is, what does the complaint force you to do? Aha! Here's a good example.
Go!
Do it?
No,
for example,
I heard a noise on the computer.
If you've doubled over in pain, then you are better for
bending
double trouble. So basically, your illness is
forcing you
to
do certain things.
Yeah, like, oh, I got to go lie down.
Like cover your cover your eyes.
Or go to the bathroom and vomit, or whatever it is.
And then we would want to know, are you better afterwards? Because Ipecac is not better for vomiting.
Okay. So, is there a remedy better for vomiting?
Nux vomica is.
Oh, yeah, that would make sense. Mm-hmm. And, like, did you ever have chattering teeth?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, pretty bad. But, you know, there's nothing that you can do. It's your illness has made you go into that state of being. Mm-hmm. And so those are the clues that are going to really help you. Number 7, concomitants. And a lot of people might not know, what is a concomitant? Along for the ride.
Yeah. You'd be surprised. People don't realize that something has come along with their complaint, like their headache. They don't just have a headache. They're also nauseous.
Okay.
Or they're, they're also walking bent over.
Mm-hmm.
Their eye is running, or just their left eye is running, or their left nostril is running. There's almost always something else. Maybe they're burping.
Gas, flatulence. And what I'm thinking is about people who have a headache, but they also have a lot of pressure around their eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Would that be like a concomitant?
I suppose so.
Okay.
If that's along for the ride.
Okay. If anybody out there, you know, I forgot to tell you folks, I don't know who's listening, but if you're in the United States, you can always call in, comment, and question at area code 919-518-9773. 919-518-9773. And if you are international calling in, you can do that on Skype at Computer2KVoice. And Amnon, are you still there with us? He probably left us alone to do the show on our own.
Uh-huh.
Are we still? Are
oh,
we
great.
Still?
The producer's gone.
Ross would never abandon Frasier.
Is anybody still there? Okay. No sound. Okay. So if anybody does have a question, we would love for you to call in. And you know what? I forgot to switch back to the live chat, which I will shall do. If anybody wants to talk to us, we are actually live today, and see if anybody has a comment. Just wave hello in the chat to let us know that you're there. And we're going on with the questionnaire, number 8, discharges.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so these are things that are coming, being produced by the body in any of orifices or, right? And we're getting to actually see something that the body is showing us.
Mm-hmm. And see, it's just that certain remedies are known for thick discharges or thin watery discharges or discharges that burn.
Yeah, and, arsenicum.
Or, right. And what do they say about Allium sepa and euphrasia, that they're opposites?
They
that,
do.
Euphrasia has the burning eye discharge but the bland nasal discharge.
Uh-huh.
And Allium sepa has the burning nasal discharge and the bland eye discharge.
Is that true?
I think so.
Well, when I cut an onion, my eyes are squinting from the burn. So I don't know. But that's what they say.
Yeah. So that's why we ask about discharges.
It also seems to me that to put that on the table, that people might be kind of embarrassed to say, you know, I've got this thick, goopy, yucky-colored stuff coming out of me. Wherever it is coming out, or even my odor, what do I smell like? I mean, these are kind of personal, private things that you might not want to say. So are they pretty honest about answering these?
Well, I know pretty much solved one case on the basis of odor. Mm. It was Kelly's son. And
what is it?
Kelly, our friend Kelly, who she used to do the quiz with me.
Oh, okay.
And she picked up on the fact that there was a terrible odor coming from him.
Okay.
And that's what put her on to Baptisia. Oh. She had been giving gelsimium.
Okay.
And then she said, wait a minute, I think I'm overlooking something here. And as soon as she tuned in to the bad odors, she got the right remedy.
Okay.
And cured him. That was good the job. Most important. That was the most striking feature of the case was the bad odors.
The bad odors. Now, I think about mercurius.
Yeah.
Mercury for having a bad odor.
Mm-hmm.
So how would I know? Would it have to go along with having a thick coated tongue or worse at night with a lot of sweating? And this is not something that you would see with Baptisia?
Well, I guess her clue was it looked like a gelsimium case.
So close.
She gave gelsimium. It wasn't working. Then she noticed the bad odors. And it was an easy step from there to Baptisia. I think, isn't it more with mercury, isn't it more bad breath? That they're
bad
not
breath.
For.
Okay,
yeah.
So this is body odor.
Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah, that's good to know. Okay. So we're really learning a lot here.
I hope so.
Yeah, we are. We've got to go through all these steps to find an answer. But if you know right off the clue, then that's good. And you really should be learning a lot of these remedies by heart so you can recognize them without having to start doing a lot of studying, right? Because if it's an acute case, it needs an immediate attention.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, then we have number 9 is generals. These are all the symptoms that begin with the word I.
Right.
Okay.
I'm hot.
Okay.
I'm cold. I'm shivering. I'm nauseous, I'm depressed, I'm anxiety ridden, I'm having a panic attack.
Okay. So when we would look them up in the generals section of the...
Or the mind, they would fall in generals or the mind chapter.
Okay. So that is the repertory, the book of symptoms. And then you usually confirm your selection, your remedy selection in the Materia Medica.
Hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, we're going on to the mentals. Oh, what's this one? I want pickles.
Oh, yeah, that's another possible response to the generals. And it's another I state.
Okay.
I want pickles, I want water, I want ice.
Mommy, get me. Is that different?
No.
If you say, Mommy, get me a glass of water.
Yeah, that's I want water.
That's So you have to be able to decipher it. Okay, number 10, the mentals. Is the complaint changing you mentally and emotionally?
Yeah, that's a really important question.
And they're all important.
Us.
Okay, what does that mean?
Well, it's like I remember one case I solved. It was a lady who had had a cold that had gone on for a very long time. And I got to the question on mentals.
Mm-hmm.
And she said that her boyfriend was really getting on her nerves.
Ooh.
And she was just about ready to cut him loose. I mean,
woo,
she could not bear his presence another minute. And of course, what are you thinking of?
Don't get, I don't know.
Sepia.
Oh, it's, oh, okay.
It was sepia. She had a sepia cold.
Oh, it was a sepia
cold? Yeah. Very unusual. And that's how I got it. Her, she had an aversion to her boyfriend, who was, you know, her live-in with her boyfriend.
Okay.
And she was developing an aversion to her boyfriend, which is a sepia keynote.
So did she really need to leave him?
No. She just needed the remedy.
She just needed the remedy.
That
and
was
she went
the
back.
Mental. That was the mental concomitant of that virus.
Did you hear that, all you guys out there, all you women who want to leave your partner? You might just need a dose of sepia, and then things will calm down.
Maybe.
But maybe. We don't know why she wants to leave.
Right.
And maybe we'll...
Well, this is a concomitant to a virus. It's not the case. It's not the chief complaint.
Okay.
This is the concomitant.
Right, because you said this is a complaint that changes you mentally and emotionally. Normally, she wants to be with him.
Mm-hmm.
And then, on this occasion of an illness, she decides she doesn't want...
That's an aversion to her
boyfriend. Okay, so... As long as it's not like a continual state of being, right?
Right. That's not the chief complaint. That's what.
Okay.
It's the mental concomitant.
So these mentals that we're looking at are like a person who normally is cheerful all of a sudden starts weeping. A person who has a clear, sharp mind is now dull or confused.
Mm-hmm.
A person who is very passionate can all of a sudden feel indifferent.
Apathetic, yes.
Good, good. Oh, shall I quiz you? Okay. Number 11. What have you been saying?
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
Oh.
I like that one.
Okay, tell us about what you've been saying.
What have you been saying?
What is that?
Well... Let's say a person has been saying, I want more water. I want more water. I want more. Or.
My daughter used to always say, take me home.
Yes.
But you are home. Take me home.
Yeah, and that would be a good one.
Bryonia?
Yes.
Yeah, that works for her.
Yeah.
Okay. Or what is this one? Turn that music off.
Yeah, turn that music off. That would mean they're very sensitive to noise.
Okay.
The cold or whatever they have has affected their sensitivity in the respect of not being able to tolerate noise.
Right.
And some people are even more specific, will say, I can't stand hearing people talk. I'm telling everyone to be quiet.
What
to
is that
stop
remedy?
Talking. It's in the repertoire.
We'll have to look it up.
Yeah, sensitive to voices.
Sensitive to voices.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So if they say that, you have to know how to interpret it to find the rubric.
Right.
So does anybody out there have some things that you find that you are saying when you're sick? And these are the best clues that you can have because if your body is speaking. You know, you're not putting the words in your mouth. Your body is putting the words in your mouth, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. So, like, if you normally just want regular water, all of a sudden you say, I want ice
water. Yeah,
so
definitely.
That phosphorus or?
Phosphorus, yeah.
Okay. Number 12, what are you doing?
Oh, yeah, that's another good one.
They're all good.
That's another good one because someone might say, I'm sitting bent over like
this. We kind of did that one, right?
Yeah.
But we could say like tossing and turning, restless, or playing with their fingers, picking their fingers or picking their lips or what?
Biting their nails pacing. I'm pacing. I can't stay in one place. I have to get up and move.
So this one is very similar to another of the questions, but I guess it confirms it because it gives them a chance to think
to say it again if they failed to say it the first time. Yeah.
Right. To say it again or to say it in another way or to think
or
about
to keep
it.
Or saying it. And if you keep saying, if if you're reading someone's questionnaire and you keep seeing this over and over again, and you get the impression, oh, this person doesn't do anything but drink water. That's all she's doing is drinking water. Mm-hmm. I had a case like that recently.
You did?
Yes, where all she was, that was the biggest part of the case.
Can you tell us more?
The obsession with water. It was a recent quiz. I had two recent quizzes where the most striking thing in the case was the consumption of water. And I knew that whatever the remedy was, it was going, no, I don't need any water. Whatever the remedy was, it was going to have to be in that rubric, that thirst.
Okay.
It couldn't be a thirstless remedy. That was out of the question. It wasn't going to be pulsatilla or gelsimium or any other thirstless remedy. That was not going to be it.
Okay, so pay attention to what the person is asking for and doing. Number 13, we're going in a little bit deeper because it says describe your thirst and appetite.
Right, because In fact, I had a case once where the child in question was eating butter off the stick.
Eating butter off the stick?
Yes. It was a tonsillitis case.
Okay.
And the most striking feature of the case was that she was eating butter.
That is bizarre.
Yes. So, of course, the remedy was what?
I'm going to say pulsatilla.
Yes.
Yay, I got one. Okay, pulsatilla loves butter.
And then guess what?
What?
The same child relapsed a week or so later. And she wasn't eating butter anymore. So guess what? The remedy was not pulsatilla. Again, even though it was the same case, the same diagnosis, tonsillitis.
Okay.
The same sensation.
Okay.
The same appearance, but no butter consumption, no pulsatilla. It was a straightforward belladonna case at that point, just what you might expect.
So
with red tonsils.
Red tonsils,
yeah.
Belladonna.
Right.
So in this case, do you feel like when you give a remedy, it kind of moves the person out of that into something else? Or does it come back again and you have to repeat when you have a recurrence
it's
like that?
Just the idea that in homeopathy, the diagnosis doesn't help you that much. That's why we have all these questions.
Mm-hmm.
Because you might get a remedy for tonsillitis based on the fact that you're eating butter.
Mm-hmm. Not on having a swab or looking at your tonsils or something like that. But sometimes you do want to look to if there's pustules to see.
Because the second time when it came back, it was a straightforward tonsillitis case where we were doing, you know, what's the sensation? What does it look like? So it was a belladonna, more in line with what you would expect.
While you're saying this, I'm thinking belladonna is one of those, the first question, it's a quick onset. And it comes on strong and it comes on fast.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get the remedy, like the belladonna, does it disappear as quickly as it came on? Or does it take days? Oops, we have people. Oh my gosh. Oh, great. Good start. Keep talking. Okay, we're going to be taking care of a couple little kids. Well, too bad we can't cut that out of the
tape. Oh, yeah, it was too bad, wasn't it?
Did we lose you?
Who did we lose?
We're having a real live show here, folks, with glitches and all. Okay. We will be taking care of those children later. Okay, so now we're up to what? Number 14, fever. And so typically because it is an acute, we might often have a fever.
We might end the show because it's 2:30.
Wow.
Oh, well, okay. Amnon, are you there? I tried to talk with you.
I'm here.
Oh, I tried to get your sound a little while ago. So do we want to finish this?
Yep.
Yes?
Yes, ma'am. Please.
Finish the show?
Yes, please.
Okay, we're going to do that now.
Let me just say that my questionnaire can be found on my website at elainelewis.hpathy.com. So if we don't get through the whole questionnaire today, and it's, you can find it under a flurry of questions.
Mention the URL again.
Okay. Hpathy.com.
No. elainelewis.hpathy.com.
Okay. And we're really thankful that you're all here watching the show, and we're going to wave goodbye. We'll be back on Monday for a broadcast, and the following week, look on the main page of Homeopathy World Community to see who our guest will be. Thank you, Amnon, for taking care of me, as always, and thank you, Elaine. It's been enlightening, and we've learned a lot together. So thank you.
And tune into the HPathy E-Zine every month.
Okay.
And try and take the quiz.
Take Elaine's quiz, because you're going to be looking at her cured cases.
Right.
Okay. Bye-bye now.
Goodbye.
Mom.
You are tuned to the Nissan Communications Network. Our weekly lineup of call-in programs includes Computers 2K Now with Amnon Nissan, Sundays 9 a.m. to noon, Health In with Debby Bruck, Mondays 11 a.m. till noon, The Scope of Things with Marilyn Shannon, Mondays 7 to 8 p.m., Breaking Free with Marilyn Shannon, Mondays 8 to 9 p.m., Reawaken Your Brilliance with Julie Seibert, Wednesdays 8 to 9 p.m., and if you tuned in too late, you can always watch each program in its entirety or download an MP3 audio file of it at www.nissancommunications.com.